In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you, we praise you, and we love you. Thank you, Lord, for bringing us all to the knowledge of the truth. Thank you, Lord, for bringing us all into your presence to understand the truth. Thank you, Lord, for this grace, for this mercy, for this love endures forever. O Holy Spirit of God, as I submit myself to your most holy hands, help us understand every day where we are going wrong, where we are lacking, where we need to learn, where we need to know, what we need to do, where should we not be shaken in our faith. Holy Spirit, you are the one, our convictor, you are the one, our helper that God has sent us. And thank you that as you teach us, every word that goes into our hearts is a lesson to us for our future. And as we apply God's word, we see signs, wonders, and miracles following us. We ask this in the mighty and glorious name of Jesus. And all God's people said, amen, amen, and amen. Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Amen. Okay. So, is my screen visible?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Jesus. So, the topic says, having knowledge does not mean you have faith. Why did I choose this topic? Is because I have seen many, many people who know the word of God. Every scripture, everything is known. They know everything what God is doing for them. But somewhere, they are getting afflicted by whatever trials and tribulations are coming their way. Somewhere they cannot take that. Somewhere they feel that they are losing the battle. Somewhere they feel that, is God there? Is God not there? Somewhere they feel, am I worthy or am I not worthy? Why is it not happening? And that is only because they lack faith. They know everything, but they lack faith. We have seen it in many cases. Now, as I go further, I have chosen three examples from the Bible. Three examples of faith. Only three. There are more, but I chose three because let us keep it within time for that reason. Okay? So let's go. Let's understand, what does this title mean? What does it mean actually? Yeah, I have brought three people from the gospel. So I will be reading it very fast, just to give us an idea about which situation they are and what is their faith level. In further, we will discuss about it. Okay, so Matthew chapter 8 verses 5 to 13. Jesus heals a centurion's servant. When he entered Capernaum, a centurion came to him, that is Jesus. When Jesus came to Capernaum, a him appealing to him and saying, Lord, my servant is lying at home paralyzed in terrible distress. And he said to him, I will come and cure him. That is, Jesus told the centurion. Then the centurion answered Jesus, Lord, I am not worthy to have you come under my roof, but only speak the word and my servant will be healed. For I also am a man under authority. Jesus, that even I got authority, and my authority is with the soldiers. They are under me, and I say to them, go, and he goes. To the another one, I say, come, and he comes. And to my slave, I say, do this, and the slave does it. So when Jesus heard him, Jesus was amazed and said to those who followed him, truly I tell you, no one in Israel have I found such faith. I tell you, many will come from the east and west and eat with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven, while the heirs of the kingdom will be thrown into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. And to the centurion, Jesus said, go, let it be done for you according to your faith. According to your faith. And the servant was healed at that very hour. Means the moment Jesus saw this faith of the centurion, that servant of the centurion was healed. Now Jesus did not even have to go to his house. And the centurion is just a Gentile, does not know the scriptures, but he knew Jesus. Okay, so let's read further. This is one type of faith. Okay, second, Mark chapter 4, verses 21 to 43. A girl restored to life and a woman healed. When Jesus crossed again in the boat to the other side, a great crowd gathered around him, and he was by the sea. Then one of the leaders of the synagogue, named Jairus, came, and when he saw him, when Jairus saw Jesus, he fell at his feet. The leader of the synagogue, the leader who knew the scriptures, he fell at Jesus' feet and begged him repeatedly, "My little daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her so that she may be well and live." So Jesus went with Jairus. Okay, so he went with him. Jesus went with Jairus. And a large crowd followed him and pressed in on him. Now there was a woman who had been suffering from hemorrhages for 12 years. She had endured much under many physicians and had spent all that she had. And she was no better, but rather grew worse in her finances, worse in her health. Because it is said that whatever she had, she spent. Okay. She had heard about Jesus. So that she has no knowledge. She knew nothing. She just heard somebody saying something about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak. For she said, "But if I touch his clothes, I will be made well." Immediately her hemorrhage stopped and she felt in her body that she was healed of her disease. Immediately aware that power had gone from him, that is Jesus, Jesus turned about in the crowd and said, "Who touched my clothes?" And his disciples said to him, "You see the crowd pressing in on you? How can you say, 'Who touched me?'" He looked all around to see who had done it, but the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came in fear, trembling, fell down before him and told him the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." Amen. On the other side. While he was still speaking, some of the people from the leaders, that is from Jairus's house, from the synagogue leader's house, came to say, "Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further?" But overhearing what they said, Jesus told the leader of the synagogue, "Do not fear, only believe." He allowed no one to follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. When they came to the house of the leader of the synagogue, he saw a commotion, people weeping and wailing loudly. When he entered, he said to them, "Why do you make a commotion and weep? The child is not dead, but sleeping." And they laughed at him. Then he put them all outside and took the child's father and mother and those who were with him and went in where the child was. He took her by the hand and said, "Talitha kum," means, "Little girl, get up." And immediately the girl got up and began to walk. She was about 12 years of age. At this, they were overcome with amazement. He strictly ordered them no one should know this and told them to give her something to eat. Okay, this was it. I read about three people and I read it very fast. Okay, I request you all to go and see it again, but we are going to discuss about it. When we are going to discuss, you will surely understand what I want to speak. Now, we seen three people here. Okay, the slide. Now, we've seen the centurion, we've seen Jairus, and we've seen woman with the issue of blood. Now, I have taken only three examples. What is the centurion's knowledge? Nothing, zero. The centurion is just a Gentile who does not know the scriptures, but he heard about Jesus. Somebody told him about Jesus. Okay, he heard about him. And when he came to Jesus, he said, Lord, even I am a person of authority. For example, Brother Lewis has his own business. So he is a person of authority. When he tells his servant, do this, the person who's working under him, his subordinate, he says, do this, he'll do that. You do this, you do that. You go to this customer, he go. You go and bring the money from the bank, he goes. So he is a person of authority. In the same way, the centurion told Jesus that I am a person of authority. When I tell my soldier, go here, he goes here. When I tell my slave, you do this, he does this. So Jesus, you also got that authority to speak from your mouth. And you just be here, you don't even come, but you just release the word and it shall be done. So, when we see this, okay, now look about Jairus on the other hand. Now, Jairus is the leader of the synagogue. What is a synagogue? A synagogue is a place where people come to learn the word of God from the leader. He is the leader of the synagogue. He's leading the synagogue. People are looking upon him, but even after knowing the scriptures, even after knowing what God can do, what did Jairus do? Jairus fell down at the feet, pleading, come and lay your hands on my daughter. Jairus said, come. Centurion said, don't come. Can we see the difference? Centurion did not know the knowledge of the word. He did not know the word. But his faith was so strong that he told that Jesus, you don't even come. Your words, release your word and your word will go and do the work. But Jairus said, you come. So he was having the knowledge of the word, but there was less of faith. So that's why the title says, having knowledge does not mean that you have faith. Right? Now, on the other hand, let us look at the woman with the issue of blood. Now, Jairus is learned. Jairus is rich. Centurion is a Gentile. Okay, woman with the issue of blood is a poor woman. She's also illiterate, not having much knowledge of the word. Okay, and now she heard about Jesus, like how our neighbor will come and say, hey, you know something over there, there is a sale going on. You know, there is a new doctor in the town and the doctor is very good. Why don't you, like, you know, if you have a problem, visit him. Suppose if there is a new shopping mall coming up, we say, why don't you go and see that shopping mall? So we are the people who are hearing. And then what we say? We heard about it. Okay, we heard about it from somebody. So in the same way, the woman with the issue of blood heard about Jesus. Somebody told her about Jesus. And now when somebody told her about Jesus, she said, if this man got so much of power, okay, this somebody who is known as Jesus, if that Jesus got so much of power, I don't even have to go and speak to him. I'll do one thing. As I'm unclean, I cannot go and show people myself. I will go and touch his garment slowly. And I'm sure he's a man of God. He's a man of power. He's a man of the righteousness of God. And surely I will be healed. What does this woman do? She didn't even go in front of Jesus. She didn't even want him to know anything. She said that I will only go and touch whom? Jesus? Did she say I'll touch his hand? Did she say I'll touch his leg? Did she say I'll touch his head? Did she say I'll go and touch his shoulder? No. I will touch that small piece of a garment, that small piece. I will touch that and I am surely going to get healed. She was so sure about it. So sure. So it depends on our faith. How much faith are we carrying? How much faith are we telling the Lord, Lord, we have this faith in you. We are yours. We do not have to know all the scriptures to know faith. Faith is Jesus, I love you. That's faith. That is faith. I love you. I am your child. I am your inheritance. I want to give my life to you, Jesus. I want to do what you told me to do, Jesus. That's faith. That is faith. And that is exactly what we are learning today. Okay? Now, let us see further. Oh dear, what happened? Yeah. So let's see further. Now, I have brought the same teachings, whatever I read earlier, I brought it back. Okay? But I brought it back just to understand the differences now. Let us understand the difference from what we read. Okay? Now, Jesus says, over here it is said, a centurion came to Jesus, appealing to him. Okay? And then the centurion says, but only speak the word and my servant will be healed. Means the centurion is telling Jesus, you don't even come, my servant will be healed. Even if you don't come, you only release your word from here. We are made in the likeness and image of the Lord. Death and life lies in the authority of our tongue. What do we speak? Are we releasing that faith? Are we releasing the words that have to actually suit our life? Suit our family, suit our children, or are we going against our own words? Let us understand. We are also made in the same authority, in the likeness and image of God. So let us speak the words, because the centurion believed, Lord, even if you only speak the word, it's enough. It's enough. My servant will be healed. Okay? Now, look at this in red. When Jesus heard him, he was amazed and said to those who followed him, truly, I tell you, in no one in Israel have I found such. Have I found such faith? And what is Jesus doing? Jesus is amazed. Look what is written here. He's amazed. Jesus is amazed. You know, that is the time when we do things in the Lord. And sometimes we say, wow, Jesus, through me, you have done so much things. Through me, you have healed people. Through me, you have given the gospel. Through me, and you, that person, that soul has been saved. And that is exactly what Jesus is telling us to do. Exactly what he's saying. Okay? Now, and to the centurion said, Jesus said, go, let it be done according to your faith. According to your faith. Let us know, having the knowledge even of Jesus. I had given a teaching on there is power in the name of Jesus. I request you to see this teaching and the authority that we have in the name of Jesus. Many of us don't know that authority, and because we don't know, we only got the knowledge, but we are lacking in faith. We are doubting. I am a sinner. I don't know if I'll be accepted. I don't know if I can talk in the name of the Lord. I don't know if I say, but I have just committed sin. In the morning only I back answered my mommy. In the morning only I back answered my colleague. I don't know if I'm this. So the devil will put you every thought to take you far away from the word, to take far away from Jesus. Nowhere in the Bible it is written that Jesus will not forgive you. Once you repent and you understand your mistake and you come to God, Jesus accepts you from the depths of his heart. He does not even look at what is gone past. He does not even consider that. Right? And that's why Jesus tells the centurion, according to your faith, the servant healed in that very hour. Okay? This is one part. Let's go to the second part, what we read. Now, over here, let's read in the red. Then one of the leaders of the synagogue, one of the leaders of the synagogue named Jairus came, and when he saw Jesus, what does the leader of the synagogue do? He fell at his feet. The one who knew the scriptures fell at Jesus' feet and begged him repeatedly. Okay, see, he knew all the scriptures. Fine. Now he said, my daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her so that she may be well and live. And Jesus did not even ask him one word. Jesus did not even say, my God, you of little faith. That day that centurion came, the centurion told me, you only speak the word and my servant will be healed. Why you don't have that faith? No, Jesus didn't argue with him. Jesus was very kind enough to say, okay, I will come with you. And because it is written here, so he went with him. Okay, further. Now, over here, the paragraph speaks about the lady with the hemorrhage. Now, let's see about her. She had heard about Jesus. Okay, now the Bible is saying she heard about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak, for she said, if I but touch his clothes, I will be made well. So her faith was, I don't want to go in front of him. I don't want to speak to him. But because he's a man of God, I will only touch his clothes and I will be made well. That is the faith, even without the knowledge of the scriptures. Now, look over here what Jesus tells. Who touched me? Now, can you believe this? There is crowd, okay? Now imagine if there is a prime minister. Okay, prime ministers are taken care by the bodyguards. There is a celebrity, okay? A celebrity, a star comes, maybe a sports star, maybe a television star, we don't know, any star. And now people want to meet that star. People want to take selfie with that star. People want to touch that star. People want to talk to that star, okay, to that celebrity. They want to talk to, they want to touch, they want to take a selfie. They want the world to see that I'm standing with this celebrity. Now, in such a case, if anybody decides that I want to go and touch this star, will it be possible? Is it possible? No, it is not possible. Imagine the celebrity who will be in between will not be even seen by somebody else. And this woman, who was having a hemorrhage, she was already weak, because 12 years is not a small thing. It's a very big, big thing. So she was already weak. And when she was already weak, now she's saying, I will go and touch his garment. And now when she touched his garment, what did Jesus ask? Who touched me? You think Jesus must be not knowing who touched her? Who touched him? Will Jesus not know even this much? If Jesus, who could speak his word and heal the centurion's daughter, will he not know who touched him? He knows it. He knows it. But he asked so that she could come, so that she could understand. She could be there and tell the people about herself. He wanted her to testify what happened to her, so that because of her, many will be saved. She thought that she was unclean. She thought she was unholy. And that's why she cannot touch, she cannot go and talk to him. And that's why she decided to do it in silent, in secret. So Jesus is giving a lesson to us all. Sometimes we may be feeling guilty. Sometimes we may be feeling, no, I'm not worthy of the Lord. Sometimes we may be feeling, no, I've sinned. I don't think I should pray this prayer. Sometimes we may be feeling so guilty that we don't even want to look at the altar. We don't want to look in the eyes of Jesus. We don't feel like going to church. Why? Because I'm guilty of one sin that I've done. But unless and until you go to Jesus, your sin, your guilt, your distress, your sorrow, all that is eating you up will not go, because he is the one who takes it in his body and gives you his peace. He is the one to tell you, give me your burdens and I give you my yoke, which is lighter. So with Jesus, unless and until I touch him, unless and until I be in his presence, it will not take away my unholiness. It will not take away my guilt, my shame. Instead, the devil will be more in shame. The devil will use me more in shame. He'll torture me. He'll torment me. He'll say, no, you're not fit for the word of God. You're not fit. You're not fit. You are a sinner. You are a sinner. And because he said you are a sinner, now that person will also go and commit a suicide. Because that person will go into self-guilt. So let us learn from here. Over here, the Lord says, even if you are unclean, you speak up. I am your father. Nobody will say anything. And who did the Bible record that anybody said anything against her? No, the Bible did not record. Means Jesus had that much power and authority that nobody could even touch a sinner. Nobody could even touch a person who's unholy. What did we see with Mary Magdalene? What did Jesus tell the crowd? Whoever sinned first, whoever did not sin, will lay the first stone. Because we all are sinners. So how can we term somebody else a sinner? I cannot have a grudge on anyone. I cannot have any wrong thinking for anybody, because I myself am doing a wrong thing in my life, which I am not realizing. So Jesus wanted the entire crowd to know that this is a woman, even if she's unholy, even if she's unclean, she is mine. She is mine. And I can do anything to my children who feel that they are in shame, who feel that they are in guilt, who feel they are in disorder, who feel that they are not worthy, who feel that they cannot stand in the presence of God. No. He says, here I am, my daughter. Here I am with you. And that is what he says. And then what he says, daughter, your faith has made you well. Your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease. Means no more will she be getting that disease any longer, because she has testified. And once she testified, the Lord made her whole, made her complete in that. Amen. Let's see further. Now, over here. Now, over here, Jesus is telling Jairus, do not fear, only believe. Why? Because some people came from his home and said, your daughter is dead. Now imagine, okay? Imagine. We are in a position. We are at home. And suddenly somebody comes and says, hey, listen. Your colleague is no more. Your cousin is no more. How will we react? What will our face show? Will it show happiness? No. Our face will suddenly change. Our emotions will suddenly change. Our body attitude will suddenly change. The body language will suddenly change. Exactly that happened to Jairus. When he heard from his servants that, listen, don't trouble this person anymore. Don't trouble this master anymore. Don't trouble this teacher anymore, because your daughter is no more. Suddenly the expression on Jairus changed. Suddenly the body language changed. And what did Jesus do? Jesus saw at that. He saw what Jairus was going through. And because he saw, Jesus said, even before Jairus could open his mouth, Jesus said, listen, Jairus, do not fear. Do not fear. Do not let that spirit of fear enter you. Do not let that kingdom of darkness enter you. Do not let that evil spirit take charge over you. Do not give access to that evil spirit. Just believe. Just believe. Do not fear. Just believe. This is what Jesus was telling Jairus. Okay? Now, when Jesus entered the house of Jairus, see in the red down, why do you make a commotion and weep? The child is not dead, but sleeping. Are we getting a study over here? Are we getting to learn something over here? Jesus is saying, the child is not dead, but sleeping. Whenever we see lack in our finances, whenever we are jobless, whenever we do not have a child, whenever we are having a relationship issue, whenever there is too much of workload in the office, whenever somebody is acting funny with us, whenever somebody is, trying to argue with us, not be good to us? Are we speaking what we can see? Or are we speaking what we want to see? What did Jesus do here? Can you see? What did Jesus say? The child is not dead. Whereas she was dead. But Jesus said what he wants to see and not what he can see. In the same way, we also ought to not see what we can see, but we ought to speak what we want to see. This is a learning. This is a teaching for us. We need to imitate Jesus. What did Abba Father do when he created the world? It is very well said in Genesis chapter 1 verses 2 that the earth was void. It was formless. It was dark. It was only water all over. It was having no shape, no nothing. But what did God say? Oh my God, this is so dark. This is so formless. Did God say that? Or did God say, let there be light? Because God himself, God the Father himself want to teach us about it. So he himself want to teach us about it and tell us that, come on, speak your faith out now. Still, tell the Lord, thank you, Jesus, for blessing me with a wonderful job. Thank you, Lord, that I am going as an ambassador over there in my job, in my workplace. Thank you, Lord, you have blessed me with children. I've got anointed children. And my children are going to the ends of the world and preaching your gospel. Thank you, Jesus, for there is food in my house. Thank you, Jesus, I'm a prosperous man. Thank you, Jesus, you have filled me with abundance. And I take that abundance and I go out and I bless people in your kingdom. Can we speak what we want to see and stop what we can see? Right? So let us learn. Let us learn from this slide. What does this slide say? Do not fear the first lesson. Do not go into that emotion when somebody gives you a bad news. I'll tell you all over here. One of my relative gave me a news. Okay? Gave me a news that another relative is contracted COVID-19. But when I heard that news, I was very calm. Very calm. Cool. So my relative asked me, hey, listen, Vienna, I told you something, you didn't even react. Do you know about it? Did you get the news already? I said, no, I didn't get the news. Then how come you did not react? I said, because I know the word. I know the end result. And that person is not, he is not positive. I'm telling you even that. Now, I said it so confidently, even without knowing the result, even without knowing the report. When I said it confidently, okay, now after 2 days, this same relative of mine who told me about, suppose I'll say A and B, okay? So when A told me about B, that B has contracted COVID and I did not react. Now A comes to me after 2 days and A says, hey, listen, Vienna, B does not have COVID, yeah? I said, yes, I knew about it. I knew that he did not have COVID. Now, why did I react like that? Why did I respond like that? I responded like that without any reaction is because I know my God. And when I stand in faith, my faith is victory over the world. It overcomes every fear. It overcomes every activity of the enemy. So the Lord says, speak what you want to see. I spoke what I wanted to see. I told my relative A, he does not have COVID. Did I speak what I want to see? Yes, I did speak what I want to see. I did not bother what the report said. I spoke what I want to see. This is what the Lord taught me, that you speak what you want to see. When you speak, you will get it. It is the promise of the Lord in Mark 11:24. It's the promise. Believe it and receive it. For when you believe and receive, it is yours, the Lord says. So every promise is there. We know the scriptures. Are we having that faith? Are we having that faith? That is more important. We know every scripture. Are we having the faith? That is more important. Faith is important. Okay? Let's go further. Now, the last slide of whatever explanation it is. Now, see. They laughed at him, right? What did Jesus do? he put them all outside and took the child's father and mother. Now, he put them all outside. There are many people in our life, even I face up till now, okay? And I know that they will come. Some people will come, still come, to put us down. Some people will come to demoralize us, demotivate us. Some people will come to put us in fear. Some people will come to laugh at us. Some people will come to tease us. They will. But what is my response to that? Am I going to get angry? Or am I going to say, I love you in the name of Jesus? What am I going to say? I am going to respond in a good way, but I will see that I do not mingle in these people who speak negative, who speak against the word of God. Because if I mingle with the people who speak against the word of God, what is going to get into me? Negativity only. So might as well I choose my people to who are in the word of God. At the same time, not leaving the people who are not in the word of God, but praying for them first. Because what has happened is their minds are blinded. Their minds are veiled. It's veiled by the enemy. And if I tell them anything now, they will retaliate. They will react. They will say, and they will make more mockery of me. So how can I make these people, how can I bring these people in the word of God? I can bring these people in the word of God by showing a change in my nature, by showing a change in my attitude, by showing love. Even if they are mocking at me, even if they are teasing me, even if they are demoralizing me, demotivating me, yet I tell them, I still love you. And now when I still love them, they will say, what is this girl? Yeah, we are actually trying to push her down. In the office, there are some people who try to push you down, who try to go and gossip about you, who go and speak, who conspire about you to your seniors because they want you down. But where is your faith? Is your faith on human? Is your faith going to be decided by a human? Or is according to your faith going to be done by God? That is the challenge we need to take. That is where we stand in the word of God. That is our faith. And that's why Jesus put them all outside. So what have we to do? Put them all outside. Just keep these people far away from you, who demotivate, who brings you, who tells you no, that there is no God. It will not work. And then you go demoralized. No, so might as well you pray for them. Show them your attitude. Show them your love. Show them your life. Once they see your life, now they'll say, wow. Wow, I want that. I want that what she has. I want that he has. And now what happened? The people whom you put outside will automatically come inside to learn from you, to take the taste of God from you, to take Jesus from you. Amen? Now, let's see further in the red. At this, they were overcome with amazement. Now, this word amazement, okay? Jesus, we read in where the centurion was. Okay, let us go behind. Yeah. Over here. Can we see this? Amazed? Who was amazed here? Jesus. Jesus was amazed at the centurion's reply. He was amazed. Wow. Jesus said, wow. Is this also the faith you carry? Wow. Okay, now, what did Jesus do here? Jesus was happy with this and he said, daughter, the woman he never knew, but he said, daughter, your faith has made you whole. Go in peace and be healed. So this is what Jesus appreciated, right? Now, next slide. Who overcame with amazement here? Who was the one? Was Jesus coming in amazement here? No. It were the people who were there. The people of the house of the leader of the synagogue. Are you understanding this? The people who knew the word of God. The people who knew that God can do anything. Those people were amazed. Those people were amazed. So look at the difference, okay? We have to learn from this. And there are many more examples in the Bible, what we have to learn. But this I specially chose so that we know the levels of difference, the levels of our faith. So here, the centurion who was a Gentile, who had only the idea of the power of Jesus, he said, Lord, you only use the word and my servant will get healed. Only your word. You don't even come. Don't even come. Just release your word. Jairus, the leader of the synagogue, he knew everything about the word. He knew about Jesus and he knew that the power and authority that Jesus carried, he knew about it. He did not have an idea about it, but he knew about it. When he knew about it, means he got the knowledge about it. When he had the knowledge, then too, with that knowledge, he said, no, you don't release your word, but you come to my house and touch my daughter. So his faith was, unless and until you come, some of them say, only if he prays, I will get healed. Only if she prays, I will get healed. That is human faith. But when you have faith in Jesus and now you say, Lord, I am speaking the words and these words are not mine, but yours. And I know when I speak the words, I am already healed. I am already got my job. I am already got my financial assistance. I am already got a child. I have already got my promotion in office. I have already got my marriage secured. Now that is what Jesus is looking out for. He is looking out for your faith. Amen. Now, woman with an issue of blood. Now, neither she had an idea of Jesus, neither she knew about Jesus. She only heard about Jesus. Only heard. Like how I said, I heard that there is a sale. I heard that there is a new doctor. I heard that there is a new gym. In the same way, even she heard about Jesus. When she heard about Jesus, her faith said, even without the knowledge of Jesus, I will go and slowly touch his garment. And that is what her faith did. Even if that crowd was surrounding Jesus in a mob, yet she managed to go within that crowd and touch. That is because of her faith. That is because of her faith. Can we go to any crowd like this? No. If anybody stays in Bombay, if anyone stays in Bombay, I am always look it on Google. Search it on Google. And right over there, Mumbai trains. Right over there. And I bet you, if anybody can enter that crowd, and that is the same crowd what was moving with Jesus. And in that crowd, this woman says with faith that only I will touch his garment and I will get healed. How could she even think about it? That's only her faith. She spoke words of faith that I'll touch him, I'll be healed. I'll touch his garment, I'll be healed. I'll touch his garment, I'll be healed. Not even him. Garment. You know why she said garment? Because she saw that crowd would be so much. She knew about it. So she's saying, it's so impossible to touch him, but only his clothes, only one piece will touch, and that piece of his garment, which is attached to him, that will heal me. That much power, that much faith. So let us understand that our knowledge is different, faith is different. Yes, we need to have the knowledge of the word of God. With the knowledge of the word, we are talking. But when trials come, when tribulation come, see that same knowledge helps you. That same knowledge should come to your mind. That same knowledge should give you faith. Don't say, oh, I know that Jesus took everything on the cross, but now I can't bear this. Yeah. No, don't change your words. Don't say anything that goes against your words. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Now, some scriptures, Ephesians 2:8. For by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God. Okay? And Habakkuk 2:3. Now, let me go slow. For by grace, the grace is always there, okay? But we have been saved through what? Through faith. Through faith, the grace can be utilized. So it is not our own doing. For example, people say, only if I say 50 rosaries, I will get my blessing. Only if I kneel down, I will get my blessing. Only if I fast, I will get my blessing. Only if I do this, only if I do that, only this, only that. And where is faith gone? Faith is gone to Rome. So might as well God is saying, give me your faith. Show me your faith. The faith that we have in the natural world, the faith that we have on our parents, the faith that we have on a big person, the faith that we have on a person who is sitting on a higher level in the office. Okay? When we know, if we go to that person, we will get everything. That faith, the Lord is saying, bring it to me. Habakkuk 2 verses 3 says, for there is still a vision for the appointed time. It speaks out of the end and does not lie. It seems to tarry. Wait for it with faith. Wait for it with faith. It will surely come. It will not delay. So many people, they start praying, okay? The moment they start praying, they say, today I pray, tomorrow I want. Means today I'm putting the grain of wheat in the ground, tomorrow I want that wheat. Today I'm putting mango seed in the ground, tomorrow I want mango. I don't know anything. Is it possible? Just as everything has a time, even your manifestation has a time, and God knows, He's the master planner. He's the master mind. He knows when to bring that to you. You just wait on it. You wait on it. You know, when I came in the word, okay? When I came in the word, I wanted my family in the word. I was, Jesus, you were so nice. I want my family. I want. But for me to come, it took so many years. But when I came in the word, now I want fatafat. I came in the word, okay, tomorrow I want my mother, I want my sister, I want my husband, tomorrow. Why? Because I came, no? So the Lord is saying, wait on it. It will surely come. When I approached my sister and I told her about the Lord, she told me, you wait. I said, okay, I'll wait. But I told the Lord, I am going to wait. I rely on you. In the meantime, I am not leaving you. I am going to study about you. I am going to learn about you. I am going to build my faith in you. It took 2 years, 2 years. But my sister today is in the word of God. What I wanted happened, but I didn't lose my hope. I did not lose my faith. I stood on my faith. I stood on the word of God. And today she's here and totally in the word, rooted in the word, marinated, soaked in the word. Whatever comes against her, now she puts Jesus in front. You, Jesus, you go in front. This is the problem. You solve it for me. Pakka, she is like so happy about it. So wait for it. This is what the Lord is saying. Wait for it. Do not get restless. Do not go in doubt. Wait with faith. I am there. It will not delay anymore. But it is coming. Wait on it. That is what the Lord is teaching us. Hebrews 11:6 says, and without faith, it is impossible to please God. Impossible. Very clear the scripture is. It's not taking us for a big ride. It is blunt. It is straight. It is straightforward scripture. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. Amen. Let us see at some examples of victory. These are only some, okay? There are more, but I just chose less. Mother Mary, a power of faith in her. The one who believed in the word of the Lord and who brought Jesus on this earth. Faith. She said, I am the handmaid of the Lord. Be done unto me according to thy word. She did not even bother what is going to happen after Jesus comes in this world. Is she going to be stoned to death? Is she going to, people will tease her, people will mock her, people will remove her out of community? No, she was not bothered. Her faith, that was her faith, which brought her victory. A repentant thief on the cross, at the end moment of his life, the thief believed in Jesus and Jesus told him, today you will be with me in paradise. Because he repented and believed in Jesus. Joshua, in the walls of Jericho, the Lord told Joshua, go 6 days around the entire city. 7 days, blow your horns and make noise. It's so funny, no? But Joshua said, Lord, whatever you do, I will do. Whatever you say, I'm applying. What happened? The walls of Jericho came down. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they were in the fiery furnace. They took the word of the Lord. They took the name of the Lord. They were in fire. But they saw that there is a fourth person standing in the fire. The people who are far from the fire, who were actually burning them up, saw that. That was the faith, which we see in the chapter of Daniel. Okay? in the book of Daniel. So Abraham, when he wanted to bear a child, what did he do? Faith. The Lord said, Abraham, look at the stars, look at the sand. It is all your generation. Look and be blessed. Faith. Abraham and Isaac, when the Lord said, Abraham, go and give your child. I want a sacrifice. What did Abraham do? Took his child. Faith. Because he knew that the Lord promised him that I am the father of many nations through Isaac. Through Isaac. Abraham knew that. But Abraham did not question him. He didn't say, Are, but you only told me, no? That through Isaac I'll get you. Then why are you telling me to put Isaac on the fire? No? Okay, Lord, you said it, I'm doing it. Apply. Apply the word of God, my dear brothers and sisters, and you see how you are going to get blessed. Apply. Joseph in the Old Covenant, in the Old Testament, Genesis chapter 39, he saw a dream. He saw a dream where his brothers were bowing to him. He saw a dream that he became big, but the dream did not come to pass early. He went to a lot of trials and tribulations. He went to many tortures, but at last he became the governor of Egypt. So what made him the governor of Egypt? That patience. What did this scripture over here tell? Habakkuk 2:3. Wait for it. Wait for it. It will surely come. Wait for it. And that is exactly what Joseph of Genesis 39 did. Exactly the same. He waited, but he did not lose his patience. What he did do in the meantime? In the meantime, he was a good person. He went out and helped everybody. He was a cheerful person. He was, you know, he made everyone, like, kept them in one respect, one honor. He did not lose his temper on anybody. So Joseph could do that. And because of that, what did God do? He exalted him. He exalted Joseph. So everyone whom we can see over here, they all are the symbols, the signs, the victory of the faith. We need to learn. And the word of God says that he is the same yesterday, today, and forever. So if the Lord could be with these people, with all these people who kept faith in the Lord, then today, why not the Lord will keep? Tomorrow, why not the Lord will keep? Because his word is active. His word is powerful. His word is energetic. His word will never fall down. The Lord keeps his word even above his own name because it is his promise. So let us understand, my dear brothers and sisters, let us understand. Okay? Now, over here, when your faith is less, your blessings are delayed. Remember that. When your faith is less, your blessings are delayed. We can see it very clearly in the life of the centurion. The moment the centurion told Jesus, you don't come to my house, you speak the word and my servant will be healed. What happened? That very hour, that Jesus did not even have to waste that half an hour to go to his house or 1 hour to go to his house. He said that very hour, this servant was healed. What happened to Jairus? Jairus came and said, no, you come and lay hands. What happened? Faith got delayed. Okay, so what happened to the lady with the issue of blood? She came with her faith. What happened at that very moment? So can you understand what is the meaning of when I say when your faith is less, your blessings are delayed? So let us understand. Let us try to keep our faith intact so that our blessings are now. Because the Bible says, faith is now. Faith is always now. Faith is not tomorrow. Faith is not after 1 hour. Faith is now. You're getting a bad report in your hand. Your faith is now. Jesus, in the name of Jesus, I rebuke this bad report. It is not mine. Open your mouth and declare it is not yours. It will never be yours. I'm telling you. There was one brother who came to me and he sent me on my mobile his report, COVID positive. Okay? He sent me the report only. Down the report, I said, I rebuke this report in the name of Jesus because it is not written in the Bible. According to the Bible, your report is written in 1 Peter 2:24. That very brother went again in the afternoon to get himself tested, scanned or something. He came with a report saying he is negative. It all depends on our faith, my dear brothers and sisters. And he agreed with me, okay? When I said that, he agreed with me. He said amen when I wrote that. He said amen on the phone, on the chat. And he again went for a scan in the afternoon that very day. And the scan showed he got no COVID. Why? He agreed with what I said. Everything depends on our faith. Okay? Without faith, it is impossible to please God. Hebrews 11, 6. This scripture, it has to be in your hearts. The moment you get any bad news, anything, Lord, I have faith in you. Lord, you are there for me. Lord, I trust in you. Say these words and remember this scripture. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. Jesus was pleased with the centurion. Jesus was pleased with the woman with the issue of blood. He was pleased. Okay? So let us please God by our faith. Okay? So let us understand that. And now, and that is what my topic said, having knowledge does not mean you have faith. Okay? Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus, and love you, Jesus. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you, we praise you, we thank you for this wonderful, wonderful teaching. Thank you, O Holy Spirit of God, for opening our hearts, our minds. Thank you for every blessing.
Thank you for every blessing
that you have bestowed on us. Thank you, Lord, for you have given us the grace to understand your word. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for moving in us, for anointing us, for giving us the knowledge, for making us understand the truth, for giving us examples from the Bible. Thank you so much, Holy Spirit. You are wonderful. Thank you for this blessing. We ask this in the most mighty and glorious name of Jesus. And all God's people said, amen, amen, and amen. Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Amen.
Amen.